Sanchez, you son of a bitch.
Never thought I'd see Angie Flint picking ticks off a pig.
Nobody's hiring an ex-con with fake hands to build an ion engine.
Suppose I had a job that didn't care if you've done time or whatever's going on with your confusing ass hands.
I'm in.
The hell happened to them? Dwayne The Rock Johnson still marching forward. I'm your host, Badger Scale, and joining me this week is special guest co-host Joe Vekeman. It's good to have you back at long last.
Oh, yeah, it does feel like a special guest spot for me. I'm just popping up at the end like Mulder.
Yes, for the last swan song. But we do actually have a real guest, Lawrence Hewitt, fellow director over here in sunny Southern California. Say hello, Lawrence.
Hello, I am honored to be here as noted Fast and Furious lawkeeper as well as filmmaker.
Lawrence, what was that, the name of the 10th Fast and the Furious movie you were pitching to me the other night?
It's the one that, like, listen, you've heard it everywhere now, and I will die on this hill that I said it years before anybody else did, which is probably not true, but I will die on that hill, lie or not, which is it has to be Fast 10, your seatbelts. And that's the joke that's been around for so long. I will always claim that I thought of it in, let's say, what's a safe date to say? 2013. We'll stick with 2013. After Fast and Furious 6, I was like, here we go. I'm four ahead of these people.
You knew they were going to keep going.
Yeah, because people didn't cotton on to the puns until 8 when they did it first. So I was ahead of the curve.
Joe, what's the 9th one called?
F9.
Just F9?
They're just like, fuck it.
Its official title is F9, The Fast Saga.
Oh, yeah, that's sorry, there's that.
I was hoping they were going to call it the Fast R9 with an F in front of a 9. I think that would have been a good one.
God.
But we're doing okay.
But well, we have a very long title for this one, Joe. What is the name of the movie we're doing this week?
Fast and Furious presents : Hobbs ampersand Shaw.
What an aggravating title this is. Why does it have to be Fast and Furious presents?
Why are they presenting it?
Yeah, I've never heard a spinoff do that. It. Right? Nobody was like, Happy Days presents Mork and Mindy. That didn't happen.
Can you imagine if this movie was nominated for Oscars, though, and they'd have to, like, call it out, like, officially? Fast and Furious.
That would have been the dream.
I wish one of those earlier Fast and Furious films were mentioned, because then there could be, like, a controversy of, like, what's the actual title of it?
God.
That
like
would
the,
be interesting.
The fourth Fast and Furious.
Yeah, like, nobody knows what it really is.
Where they drop the those.
All right, and of course, on the audio boards is Lev Van Rensselaer, making the sound so slippery smooth. He reminds us that you can email us questions, comments, queries at whathappenedtothemcast@gmail.com. And our sponsor this week is Pork Lopes, the only pork you can pick from a tree. I'm not sure what that means, but I just read the copy. That's all I know how to do. All right, Joe, give us a plot summary of Fast and the Furious presents Hobbs and Shaw.
Well, all right, here we go. Lawman Luke Hobbs, Dwayne The Rock Johnson, and outcast Deckard Shaw, Jason Statham, form an unlikely alliance when a cybergenetically enhanced villain threatens the future of humanity.
Yeah, how did Fast and the Furious become a superhero movie? How did we get here?
Well, you know, in 2012, The Avengers comes out.
Yeah.
Yes, wow. That's exactly it.
I couldn't figure out what tone and genre this was supposed to be. It was like we were in different physics land from the submarine movie.
Where he punches the face.
Yes.
I fully agree. I made like many a note, and my first note is that, especially with some of the Idris Elba scenes, it feels like a fundamentally different movie at points.
Yeah, maybe that was the goal.
It's strange because this film is so committed to like family. They still do the family thing.
Yes, Jason Statham's family.
At the same time, it's like this movie feels like it's just a normal blockbuster that has like the Fast and Furious presenting it to us, the great audience.
Maybe that's why they had to put it in there so we would remember.
Yeah. Oh, well, I think I would forget honestly, if it wasn't in the title.
Joe Lawrence, did this movie happen because they were like, all right, Rock and Vin Diesel, stop fighting. We'll just put The Rock over here.
I believe that's what the rumors are, okay, that they were fighting on set so much, or like they were just not like getting along on set. So they're just like, hey, we'll spin you off. You're a big enough star. You and Jason we can handle this. And the movie's still like kind of underperformed, like with all like
underperformed. That means it only made $300 million in profit.
$200 million budget, but the box office was $760 million.
Oh no! Like, how awful for them.
They wanted a billion because I think the last two made a billion, and I'm like, you're missing
The Rock,
the biggest star,
Vinny, gravelly voice Vin
can't
Diesel.
Have a Fast and Furious without Vinny.
Is that
more
true,
than a
Lawrence?
Star, you're
is
missing
that
a heart?
Yeah. Okay. So go into that, Lawrence. What does that mean?
I think it's one of those things. So yeah, like this thing definitely comes out of like tensions of making eight, which I think have been quashed since because, and this is again, things I know that I don't know why I know. Vin Diesel, when the film came out, Hobbs and Shaw was like, good job on it coming out. And then The Rock posted something else on Instagram being like, thanks for supporting me, Vin. I'll see you soon, Toretto. So I think they're like, they're fine now.
Okay,
the door is open again. Mm-hmm. But the thing with this, it's like, when you're missing Vin, it's beyond just missing like your recognizable star. It's the fact that there is a earnestness which flows both through the man Vin Diesel and the films of the Fast and Furious that I think is lacking in most of this film up until you get to like the stuff in Samoa at the end. Mm-hmm. I think you just are watching something which feels, it just feels very much like a modern blockbuster of the day, right? There's nothing that separates it. I think it's just it's like perfectly serviceable. The action's pretty good. They have their banter, but it doesn't feel like Fast and Furious
okay.
at all.
What about you, Joe? Do you agree with this?
I agree completely. And it's because they got I guess he's like more of a modern action director because he directed like Deadpool 2 and he directed Atomic Blonde. And he's got a new movie coming out, I think, next year, or they're filming it this year, called Bullet Train with Brad Pitt. And I'm like, Brad Pitt's going to be like in a John Wick kind of movie. Because he was like one of the co-directors of it, like or uncredited, like one of the big stunt guys.
So what is it? He's just Brad Pitt's on a really fast train, and then like Die Hard stuff happens.
I think it's a train full of assassins who have like interconnected.
Yeah,
targets.
There we go. It's
definitely like an assassin train.
I can imagine that pitch now, where you go in and you're like, all right, what if we have a guy on a train, and they go on, and it's really fast, and it's full of assassins.
You're just pitching Murder on the Orient Express.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is.
Because like spoilers for that very old book, but I guess the thing is what they're kind of all the killer, right?
Yeah.
So you are just, uh-huh. It's just a train of assassins anyway.
That's what Brad Pitt wants to do with his first movie after his Oscar win.
Yeah, he can do whatever he wants now. He's like, all right, pay me the bills. I'm just cashing out. Let's go.
Yeah, of course.
So the first movie, right, Lawrence, this is a movie about family that's in there. We see his mother. We see all this history with his sister. What happened to his brother? Why is he not in this movie?
That's a huge part of this. Because I on my note, the second one.
Yeah.
Was Luke Evans busy or something? And I looked, he was also in six movies in 2019.
Oh,
so maybe he genuinely was busy.
Yeah.
But for a franchise that he is in seven for like a minute in the opening when he's just a comatose body, he shows up in eight just to do an action scene. It feels so strange, especially because it's like they talk about him as if he doesn't exist. Because Helen Mirren's like, I just want to see you two together again, as if she doesn't care about the son. And then at the end of the prison, it's like, would it be that hard to change? Like, she wants to see all three of them and just get Luke Evans in for a day.
Yeah, just get him in for a lunch break. Or even just putting a young brother in all those flashbacks of like the three of them pulling schemes. At least an acknowledgement that that character exists.
I think he is in one of them. I think in the Keith Moon one, there's definitely three kids.
Maybe
although both
that.
Of the kids kind of look like a young Jason Statham. So it's hard to tell, really.
I don't think I could tell what a young Jason Statham would look like unless the kid was also bald. I think that's what I would need to help.
Well, it looks like one of the kids wearing a wig, which is why I don't know. That one.
Does he have his like scowl still?
Oh, yeah. One of the kids is definitely... They're all angry-looking people and children.
Yeah.
That's like the take of the Shaw family.
Yeah.
Is that they're all angry-looking and they're all like aggressively British, except Luke Evans, who I guess because they cast him first is Welsh, and that doesn't matter.
It was like, whoops, too late. Most people disagree with me on this, but Ryan Reynolds shows up in this movie. I am so sick of Ryan Reynolds. I want no more Ryan Reynolds. I can't escape him, though. He's always doing the thing he does. I'm over it.
He's always doing Detective Pikachus.
He got drunk with Pikachu power, as I would too, to be fair. But he is, I think, a big problem with the film, not in terms of just like, I think the comedy scenes he's in specifically feel very out of place for the rest of the tone. Yeah, it's like the Kevin Hart one's the same. Delaney is the same issue. I like him more, but it's the same issue.
Yeah, it just feels so random.
We get totally derailed in this movie. I don't know why we needed to do this.
No. Those scenes, all those extended comedy bits, I think if you either cut those out completely, which makes the movie shorter. Which
oh my God, please. Better, yes. No.
Or you replace it with like, genuine, like the Fast and Furious stuff that people like me who like love the franchise no matter what.
Yeah.
It's like replace it with scenes about The Rock talking about like his family or whatever, or Statham talking about his family, or like even Statham talking about his relationship with Brixton Law, which they get into in like the very final moments of his life. But he was family, right? He was a soldier. That's something they should have dug into. And instead it's Kevin Hart on the plane auditioning to be in Fast and Furious. Like, I just, it makes no sense to me.
Very odd. And I don't know if you noticed, the Rock's daughter in that scene at the diner is reading The Old Man in the Sea for school. Who makes a third grader read The Old Man in the Sea? What is that? What was going on there?
That whole scene.
Screenwriter, like, losing their minds.
They wanted to get that joke with the old man. I don't know.
It's like in the Game of Thrones references, which are already outdated, which is like,
yes, I know.
Not the movie's fault that it fell from grace so hard.
Yeah.
But like, man, that sort of stuff. And that's the stuff to me where my biggest issue with the film comes out, which is there are a lot of scenes where The Rock is not playing Luke Hobbs. He is playing The Rock.
Yes.
Like, there's too many moments, especially when he does, like, the eyebrow and all the comedy stuff, where I'm like, you're not the guy from the Fast and Furious films.
Yeah.
You're The Rock. Like, and then there are scenes where he is that guy from the films, but so much of it is The Rock, because I guess he's a producer, right? He has the control. He's just playing The Rock.
Yeah.
And that's, like, it's a problem with the film in terms of, you pick a lane. If this film was just The Rock playing The Rock, like, that's fine. Then it's consistent.
Yeah.
But it's when he flip-flops between, like, this guy and his daughter and his like long string of jokes to the next scene where he's pointing a gun at somebody very intensely and is like, I will shoot you in the face. I'm like, that's not the guy 2 seconds ago who was like, you know, that Jon Snow fella. It just doesn't add up to me.
Yeah, he went to Luke. He was like, hey, Luke Hobbs, he's just an extension of The Rock's like personality. He's just a little bigger.
Well, now that and he's like, from Samoa. What? Yeah, that's what we did here.
Yeah.
I missed the goatee.
Yeah, I'll talk a little bit about that when we get to the Young Rock section, because I have some theories behind that choice. But did you guys notice the clever naming of Ryan Reynolds being Locke along with his old partner, Hobbs? Did you guys catch that?
I was on the floor. My brain was broken. the sheer intelligence of such an incredible move. What upset me more is he's also the voice of like the evil AI, which isn't meant to be like a reference. It's not meant to be like a hint at that character. It's that Keanu Reeves apparently was busy. And it's just that thing of like, it's like Reynolds and these Reynolds-isms are a weird presence over this film. He is like haunting this movie.
Yeah. He's like the ghost in a ghost story, just hanging around.
Just watching things
happen.
Not
saying anything, he is saying too much, actually.
Yeah. So my problem with Ryan Reynolds is, and with how long this movie is that the movie ends, and then we get some credits, and then Ryan Reynolds shows up. So more movie happens. And then we go back to credits. And then Ryan Reynolds shows up again. I just wanted the movie to be over.
Yeah, the fact that they're like, this Reynolds stuff, it's just, it's hidden. It's cracking. We need to get it all on the screen. We'll have him in two or three different post-credit scenes. Like, and you remember that brick bit from earlier, everyone's favorite joke from the Fast and Furious franchise, like a man being murdered by a brick? That'll come back. That'll land. By hour 8 of this viewing experience, the audience will really, they'll love it. They'll love that moment.
So they want The Rock to work with somebody. They don't tell him it's Statham yet. And The Rock says, no, I work alone. To which I then think, I don't think I've ever seen you work alone in any of these movies.
Yeah.
You in fact always had a partner.
Pointedly,
yeah.
Like, in almost as if this franchise is about family. that, like, that's the thing, is this movie also actively ignores the ending of the eighth film.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, because, like, they're at the family barbecue together. Yeah. In this franchise, that is the symbol of you are family now. It has become the unbreakable bond. You are never allowed to be mean to each other ever again. And this film starts, and they are so aggressive towards each other in that first scene for, like, 5 minutes. And it's like, you saved a baby together, like, I don't know, a few months ago. You had a barbecue.
Yeah,
you drank a Corona.
Yeah.
Like, and no one drinks Corona in this movie, which, again, another knock against it in terms of it being a Fast and Furious product.
So the screenplay and the story by credit goes to Chris Morgan, but then on the screenplay, Drew Pierce is also credited. And I believe Drew Pierce did the Cabin in the Woods. I think he helped write that.
That's interesting, right? That then he goes to this or can do this.
Yeah, I think that's
That's another guy. I'm sorry. What did he do?
We'll have Love cut that out, I guess.
Yeah, I always mix them up. Oh, Drew Goddard, that's who did it. Mix them up. He Iron Man 3.
That's what I was going to say. Like, I think that's a leftover from the fact they wanted Shane Black. Shane Black was the first guy they approached to direct this.
Okay.
Oh, God.
I buy that.
I don't know if it would be better or worse.
There would be a lot more, like, adolescent jokes. Probably.
Yeah. Because I'll give it this film this. It's like, the action, I think, is pretty good for the most part.
Yeah.
I think, like, the Statham hand-to-hand stuff's pretty strong. Vanessa Kirby's good. I think the Samoa stuff is good. I think the car chase in London's good. Ukraine falls a bit flat for me. But that's, like, the saving grace of this film, in of what can be a saving grace, of, like, the one Fast and Furious film I kind of don't love. But if Shane Black had done it, yeah, I don't know. That would be potentially an insufferable mess.
I mean, what I think a director... biggest contribution would be those action scenes, because I think a lot of the problems we're having with this are in the script itself, and I don't know how much he'd be allowed to change it.
I guess if you hire Shane Black, though, right, like, that comes with the expectation of, like, he writes the thing, and
okay, might be right
there.
Sure,
you know, the Predator proof that a studio will gladly destroy something that is probably already bad but will definitely make it worse. But it's very, yeah, it's like all the things, and the movie, I think, makes some smart choices. Like, obviously, the whole thing with the virus is whatever. It's like a MacGuffin. They need a thing.
Yeah.
But I don't even mind the insane decision she makes to put the virus in her.
Yeah,
because at least then we
don't
have to worry about, like, a USB stick. We don't have to worry about some, like, ethereal thing. We can at least put a name and a face on, like, the problem.
Raises the stakes.
Which I think is, like, a good call. It ties into the family stuff well. Mm-hmm. And then, like with a lot of things, I think the movie just doesn't do anything with it.
So, no, they give her a backpack, I guess, and then, like, we just have to wait 30 minutes. That isn't really 30 minutes for it to be fixed or something.
There's so many subplots, I find, that they sort of introduce and either are not interested in, like, expanding or just drop. Or with example with, like, Elba's villain, the fact that he knows Statham does not matter.
Yes, I know.
Like, it matters for the final moment where he's like, we were brothers. And I'm like, okay.
Yeah, we didn't earn that.
Like, you're right, you were, but it didn't matter. If you had introduced it as a twist in that exact moment, it would have had actually more of an impact on, I think, the audience than knowing. Because the film is so caught up with this idea of then going like, well, you know what would be funny is if when they're in the airport, they wear some silly disguises. The Rock gets stopped by whatever the UK call our TSA. Like, and then that thing goes on for 10 minutes and they take, and for some reason, and I am not someone who tends to care about these details, but it did bother me. London to Moscow is like a 4-hour flight.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, they get on like during the day and then it cuts to everyone fully asleep. They've darkened the cabin. I don't normally find stuff like that irksome, but for some reason in this film, I was like, this is a 4-hour flight. Like, what is happening here? You've broken logic in so many different ways in terms of gravity and super soldiers.
Yeah.
But implying that this plane ride is an overnight flight when you got on in the afternoon for a 4-hour trip? Like, no, that's too far.
Probably just a good way to get the sister to be asleep so they could just focus on the three men doing their
quirky bit. Have a go to the bathroom. I don't know.
Yeah.
There are so many options on a plane.
Having spent a lot of time in London, are there things that you think they got right about the scenes that took place there or things that they got wrong?
I mean, in terms of like, they utilize interesting spots of the city well, I think. Okay. Like it's a, and Six does the same thing, right? Because Six has parts set in London. And I think they're fun action scenes. I think the weird like curvy roads of like central London in particular lend themselves very well to these sort of car action scenes. And I think it's a lot of fun. It's weird that he's called Brixton Law because like Brixton's a borough, and that just always is very strange to me. And also it would make more sense. Idris Elba's from Hackney, so like you could call him Hackney Law. That sounds like a cyber terrorist thing anyway. And so I think all that action stuff works really well. And then also that was the other thing it made me realize is that for a Fast and Furious character and franchise, The Rock is not really like a driving guy. Like he's just not a car guy.
Yeah, I mean, well, that one movie, he's just walking around while everybody's driving. And he's just shooting at the helicopter. Like, he didn't need a car.
Yeah. Yeah, because in Seven, like if you are like me and go to the Wikipedia page of list of characters from Fast and Furious franchise every so often, like I do, they list the vehicles they drive in every film underneath it.
Wow.
Because you know, I care about these things, and it is funny that with The Rock, it's like Seven, it just says ambulance.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh yeah, you just got the ambulance.
That's right.
Like
yeah.
It is one of those things where. He is just not a car guy.
Yeah.
It is such a strange... It sort of goes back to the thing, and this is a sentence I never thought I'd say in my life. I think this movie would have been better if it was not a Fast and Furious movie. I think if this was just something where they liked getting on with each other, because the characters in this film are based on like behind-the-scenes interactions between the two actors, not the characters we're shown on screen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So just do like an original thing because they're big enough names. The Rock is a big enough name and Statham yeah. like has traction. I think if this was an original film, it gets to drop the baggage of like the stuff it feels like it has to have in there, like family, yeah. and gets to focus on whatever it's like 80s buddy action thing it's riffing on is, which I assume would make it a better and shorter film. Yeah.
Just like remake Midnight Run.
Yeah. Honestly, why
I
not?
I could do that. I'd be fine with that.
Kevin Hart could easily be in that. Yeah.
Yes.
They return to the franchise's roots by doing the thing where one dude falls in love with another dude's sister. Though I admire the restraint this movie had in that relationship, and they didn't go kind of full ham with it all in one movie. It's a little slower here, a little slow burn. I like that.
I would argue that sometimes it's so slow that up until the ending where they kissed, I forgot that they yeah. had been building to any sort of romance.
Who is this actress? Somebody? I don't know who she is.
Vanessa Kirby. She was in the last Mission Impossible movie. She was just in this Netflix movie, Pieces of a Woman.
Okay.
I think she was nominated for Best Actress this year. Did you know that?
For the Pieces of yes. a Woman?
For Best Actress at the Oscars, this past weekend.
I pay attention to no Oscars. I don't know anything that was in... I filled out a sheet for something, and I just sort of just guessed in 5 seconds,
wow.
and that was it. I know
nothing.
No
studying at all?
No, I couldn't do it. I was shooting a pilot. I didn't care.
Her big thing is she's in The Crown. That was her big, like, yeah, because she played Princess Margaret.
And then they said, hey, be in action movies. And she's like, great.
Yeah, and I think she's the best thing to come out of this film.
Yeah.
Honestly, I think I could easily see her, like, hanging out, well, and like Roman Reigns and stuff like that and the Samoa stuff. But, like, I could see them interacting with Vin Diesel in the future, which is how I have to grade the characters they interact. Like Reynolds, I can't imagine Ryan Reynolds' character talking to Vin Diesel.
No.
To talking to Dominic Toretto. Vanessa Kirby, all the stuff, all the Samoan characters from the Hobbs family, 100%. I think they all work. Like, I think she's pretty competent. They do some fun stuff with her in the action. Like, I like where she like puts on the bike helmet and like headbutts the Rock.
Yeah.
Like, it's almost, it's like an interesting admission of the idea of like, you know, this, he's not human. We're not going to pretend he's human. He holds a helicopter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is one of the most insane things I've ever seen in this franchise, is him holding, and that's a lot for this franchise, yeah. is him holding that helicopter. And like, and this is a movie with a super soldier.
Yeah.
And I just thought to myself, this is implying that The Rock is stronger
yeah.
than the super soldier who is on the other end of this thing, that he is like the very glue holding everything together, and that he is his strength beyond any sort of man could ever know and should ever know. Yeah. It's just crazy.
And The Rock on set's like, yeah, I can do that. Don't worry.
Yes. Or like, I don't know if that's contractually in there. Like, the super soldier can't be stronger than me. And they're like, well, do you understand what a super soldier is?
Have you ever read that piece about that, the fighting contract?
No.
I
don't think so.
Oh, the magic punches.
Yeah, you say that. Yeah.
One of our guests brought contracts. This up. Yeah, yeah.
Where it's like they can't lose a fight. If they get hit, they have to hit back an equal amount of times.
Yep.
It's insane. And I think it only applies to like Vin, The Rock, and Statham. Yeah. I don't think no offense to Ludacris, but I don't think he's on that.
He never even gets in the fights anyway, you know? He's always in the background driving cars.
I wish Luda got in there.
Yeah. That was my wish for 8, was that I wanted to see Vin Diesel and Ludacris have a fist fight. Yeah.
Oh, man. That movie had so much potential, and it just, I did not like it too much.
Yeah, so in this helicopter sequence, it begins with The Rock and his home family tribe setting a bunch of Home Alone-style traps. So, fine. But then, like, he doesn't have a shirt on for a really long time. But then once he leaves that part of the movie and goes to the car, he feels the need to take the time to put a shirt back on.
I've always found that. Yeah, I find that very strange, because I had the exact same thought of, like, oh, it's like, because I get why he has the shirt off.
Yes. Makes
because
sense.
It, and I think that stuff's really strong because it's like, and the Fast and Furious films always excel when they delve into like heritage and these sort of things. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a really good moment of like the family stuff where he's with all the other Samoans and they're like doing the chant and it does all this huge buildup and he hits the ground and makes a car explode, which is undeniably cool, and he looks great with like the tattoos on display and like the thing he's wearing around his waist, and then it's almost as if he's like, well, that was
we did this Samoan was a different bit. Man now for regular Rock,
it's like I've changed. This is not who I always am. When I go back in the car, I need to wear the shirt as if it's some sort of like important piece of iconography, as if it's like as if it's Vin Diesel's tank top.
That is true iconography, though.
I just don't know why he would take the time. Like, it's a life or death situation. Time is of the essence. But where did you even get the shirt from?
Yeah, well, that's the thing, is it was tied like around his waist because he was wearing it, then actively chooses to take it off, runs into, like, wastes, let's say, 2 or 3 seconds at a defining moment to put on a t-shirt. And it leads to, not that it would ever have plot significance, but it's just such a strange choice. Is it just a thing where they're like, I don't know, for continuity, let's just make sure he has like a shirt on, because otherwise he has to be shirtless when we're filming in the water and like he won't like that or whatever.
Rather have the wet
shirt.
What if
the shirt just spread like, I am the best on it?
That would be better.
Yeah, just like be a little more self-aware.
Or if it just had like a photo of Vin Diesel and it just had like X's over the eyes. I don't know. That would be funny.
Triple X, yeah.
See if there's anything important I actually want to say, because half of them are dumb. Half of them are either dumb puns. They're things that I no longer understand because I've forgotten so much of this movie despite watching it last night. Where I'm like, what is this time? Oh, time in a bottle. So the time in the bottle thing is crazy and bad.
Well, I don't even know what you're talking about.
The song that opens and closes the film.
Oh. No, I have no recollection of this song.
Yeah, I didn't either.
Out of your brain as soon as it's over.
I don't even know this song. What is this? Who sings this song?
It's a cover of the song Time in a Bottle, and I don't remember who originally sang it, but like, it's a good song. It's like, great, but this is like some weird emo punk band cover of it that does over the opening and over the credits. And like I said, as a testament to this film, I have here written down on my notes, Time in a Bottle twice, and I fully forgot what I was talking about, and I watched it last night.
It says it's a Jim Croce song.
I don't even know who that is.
It was in X-Men Days of Future Past. That's its big, that was the song's big breaking moment as a star.
Party. Okay, I didn't see that movie, so. Oh well. Though I heard Kelsey Grammer was in that. Is that true? Was he Old Beast?
Yes, definitely.
Well,
yes.
You know, if there was a reason to watch, that would get me in there.
Yeah, if you want maybe, I think, 5 seconds of Kelsey Grammer looking uncomfortable and saying, I think, one line, boy, do I have a movie for you.
Remember when he was in The Expendables 3? Remember when he got into that flick?
Yeah, The Expendables. Do you know what? That's sort of the vibe that I, weirdly, now that you say it, that a Hobbs and Shaw, I think, would have benefited from.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Where it just needs to be like a real like gut punch of like, we're doing action, we're doing a very simple plot,
Yeah.
Like, and any banter that comes out of this is coming entirely from like the actors, and it's, but it's still very self-serious.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, that was the interesting thing, is that that tone actually shifted through them, where the first one was a little too serious and the second one was a little too jokey. And the third one, they seemed to get the good balance there, and then they stopped making them.
Yeah, didn't I remember the third one was A, PG-13, and B, like fully leaked out online like a month and a half
really?
Before it came out.
I didn't even know that. The PG-13 is interesting because of the way some of those people died. But Mel Gibson in that movie, like, that movie took advantage of his craziness. Like, that was a good use of Mel Gibson.
Why would you PG-13 Mel Gibson? Oh, my God.
Oh, I mean, I'm sure there are legal reasons.
I mean, yes.
I'm sure there are plenty of things that Mel said that shouldn't be broadcast to the, from the public.
Let's hear them, Mel.
I wonder what those outtakes were.
Mel will tell you if you ask, or even if you don't. I think that's really the vibe I tend to get. Is he has opinions from what I've heard.
Was Mel Gibson from England? Did I make that up?
No, he's like Australian American.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
He was born in New York and then he moved to Australia when he was like 10 or something.
Prisoner England. Okay. Yeah. Gotcha.
And then, became Mad Max and all that stuff. And then,
Mad Max.
Then it worked out and then it didn't work out. That would be a what the hell happened to them, Joe.
We know what happened. He's
the thing is, it's a very simple thing with Mel Gibson, which is he's a terrible human. Yeah. He's sexist, anti Semitic, and racist. Patrick, the
he's
whole
a triple
conceit
threat.
Is they make poor career choices. Yeah. As if he didn't get nominated for Best Director like 4 years ago.
Yeah. Oh, God. Cancel culture isn't real.
That's true. For that very mediocre
canceled.
Film.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, Hacksaw Ridge is an insanely okay piece of cinema. But it's also one that when you find out who directed it, you're like, maybe let's not give this awards. Almost like Bohemian Rhapsody as well. It's weird. Oh. The Academy seemed to have a track record with not caring about these things.
I wish they never expanded it to 10 films or whatever that benchmark is. I think too much crap is now filling in here. I don't need that.
I'm so torn on it because their pitch was always like, well, so the smaller films can get in, which sure, but it never actually became that, right? It became like the year after when District 9 and Up got in, everyone was like, ooh, weird.
Yeah.
And then it was like Star Trek almost made it. And they're like, well, Star Trek didn't though, so it doesn't matter. And then it's like, ooh, Inception. And then it just stops fully. And they're like, well, what about the film Amor?
Yeah.
Or like Beasts of the Southern Wild. And they're like, what? That wasn't the point of making this bigger. You wanted people to come in to make money.
Yeah.
Like, you were like, we can nominate all the big films. And they're like, no, what if instead we picked something you will never see?
Yeah, the problem with us thinking that Bohemian Rhapsody wouldn't be in the Just Five though, because it won like multiple awards.
Oh yeah, that's the
best film that year. Yes,
the thing is like it would have been nominated for director if it hadn't been Bryan Singer.
Can you imagine? Oh my gosh,
I couldn't. Man, you know what? I'll say this for Hobbs and Shaw: from what I know about the people involved in it, they seem pretty okay.
Yes,
they're fine.
Upstanding citizens.
Jason Statham seems like a nice guy. It's like, you know, he's like a nice dude. David Leitch, I don't think, has done anything terrible. The Rock, to my knowledge, hasn't like tried to murder anybody. So if we really, on a moral level, I'd almost say this is perfect cinema.
Yeah. I know it's a MacGuffin, this virus thing, but I have no idea what it was really supposed to do. And I was also confused where at the beginning it seems like Statham and The Rock are trying to investigate the virus. But then when they're tasked to deal with the virus, they seem to have no idea about it.
Yeah, the virus thing is also calling it the snowflake is weird.
I don't know why they did that. I have no idea.
That feels like that it was called that for a reason. They made a lot of jokes and probably wisely cut them out. Like that to me has to be the thing.
Okay.
The way the virus functions is so strange because it's like, it's going to melt her from the inside out if it doesn't come out of her body. Right.
Oh, like a snowflake melts. Okay.
That's information that they are, like you said, explicitly told.
Yes.
And then when they're like, but what will this virus do? We need to find the guy who created it. And he then explains to them what the virus does. And I'm like, but the whole thing is like, you know what? I almost don't blame you. If Ryan Reynolds had been talking for that long at me, maybe I would have zoned out as well.
Yeah.
But this is your job, man. Like, you need to, there's some level of importance to this. As you said, you've saved the world four times. Yes. Like, I assume you did it by some form of listening to what the assignment was.
Yeah, and if you're going to zone out, that's a bad place to zone out with what the virus is capable of and why it's a bad virus.
Because I get when he's like calling you like Becky or whatever, you're like, yeah. And then it's like, anyway, back to the virus. Yeah. He's like, you know what? I also don't care about this.
Yes.
I can do this in my sleep. Vin Diesel listens to the assignment. Yeah. I, The Rock, shall work purely on instinct as the greatest tracker. That's like his thing, I guess. He's like a tracker.
Which I don't think I've ever seen him do. Yeah. I don't think I've ever seen him do that.
Well, he tracked down Vinny in the sixth one.
I guess, but every villain's tracking them down. Right? Charlize Theron tracked him down. Nobody's talking about her great tracking skills. I mean,
they're really easy to find, too. They're not subtle.
Yeah, that's the problem. The Rock is always going from city to city seeing what cars have exploded.
So easy to find.
Yeah, it's like, where are they in hiding? It's like, oh, there's a mansion in the middle of nowhere. Also, there's like 8 or 9 expensive supercars that keep racing around.
Yeah. Yeah. They always leave.
Where are $1 million cars being shipped? That's where we got to go.
I wish they had had a reference in the Hobbs family workshop to like, I wish they had had a car there that was like Toretto's Dodge Charger or something. I like the idea of like, I just want them to be part of this. I think that's the main problem with the thing, right? Is there's so many options and opportunities for things to be streamlined and they just refuse. It's almost like they're offended at the idea that this movie could be under 2 hours.
Yeah. Like, it's contractually, like, they're like, we don't want to film shorter than Vin Diesel's. We want to be so important. That, we're 3 hours.
Hey,
long.
if Vin gets to do 137 minutes, I get to do 137 minutes.
Yeah.
Like, this is non-negotiable. And I'm going to even tack it on. Some of my 137 minutes, like we said, will be 2 Ryan Reynolds post-credit scenes.
Yeah, yeah. Or it's like, I want 139 minutes. Like, it's like when Japan and America keep making Godzilla bigger each time they do a film. It's like The Rock and Vin Diesel keep making their movies longer.
Oh, I can't wait. I wish that would be a thing where, like, also The Rock just kept getting bigger, though.
Yeah. He was the size of the ape from Rampage.
One day in... Rampage almost got there, right?
Yeah.
Rampage was like, can we have The Rock fight a giant monster? And I have a feeling that one day we will see The Rock punch a Godzilla-sized monster in the face.
I really thought in Rampage, when he took that antidote or whatever he took out of this thing, I thought he was going to put it in himself so that he could get gigantic.
I really thought that too. That movie is not great. I was really hoping where it's like, but now what you came to see, which is 80-foot-tall Rock versus 80-foot-tall, I don't even remember what the animals are in that film. Yeah,
was alligator. It an alligator? He's supposed to be an alligator.
An alligator.
A wolf.
There's
and a gorilla.
Lizard.
The gorilla just got to be a big gorilla. I won't go into that again. I wasted enough
time. Yeah, sorry, I don't want to make you relitigate that.
So, on your note about the garage, it's weird that the Hobbs, who doesn't seem to drive cars a lot, comes from a car family, and that is odd. But also... You know, for doing callbacks to Fast and the Furious in the inevitable sequel we're getting that they set up very strongly.
Oh, yeah, it's already been set up.
Do you think that this person who clearly seems to know Hobbs is going to be from one of these earlier Fast and Furious movies? Who would be a good candidate?
I don't think it'll be someone we know, if only because they've, like, run out of that. Unless the only person who they haven't brought back in some capacity is Gal Gadot.
I don't think it would be her, but in that same movie, he has like the partner that turns out to be the bad guy. I don't know if she's a big enough star to make the bad guy of the next movie, but that could be a route you go.
Also, that person is, that was, what's her name from The Mandalorian, who is very much a canceled person.
Oh, what did she do?
Gina Carano, who has views which are... bad. She seems like a bad person who has terrible views and is now going to make movies with Ben Shapiro. So I don't think she will be back in the Fast and Furious franchise.
I see. All right. I missed all this, I guess.
I think they're going to do big stunt casting for these sort of things.
Okay.
Because I always think that this one day they will cast Dominic Toretto's father.
I see.
And it will be an old Italian man. Cause lest we forget, Toretto is canonically Italian.
It'll be
De Niro, it'll be Pacino, it'll be a Nolte, it'll be like Joe Pesci, it'll be whoever, right? And I think with The Rock...
Joe Pesci is his father.
I would love
to see it.
Oh my God, that please. Oh, bring Pesci back. He would win the Oscar for that one. No doubt.
So I think the thing is that voice, right? Like I said, is they wanted it to be Keanu Reeves.
Okay.
So it was clearly intended to be Reeves. And I guess we would have seen him in person, but I imagine that's who they're going to cast to be like the anti-Rock. Will be a action, will be like an action star. Like it'll be Keanu. It'll be like, I don't know if they'd pick Bruce Willis, but it'll be somebody like an older
generation
action star.
Just get more bald people in this movie. All the bald people need to come here.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It has to be Willis, then. It has to be Bruce Willis or it has to be Stanley Tucci.
Yeah.
Oh, so I'll take Stanley Tucci over Bruce Willis anytime.
I would also pick Stanley Tucci. Now that I've said it out loud,
yes,
I would love to see Stanley Tucci punch the Rock.
Yeah. But they'll probably get market corrected Stanley Tucci, which is Mark Strong.
I like Mark Strong, though.
Well, that's why he's market corrected Stanley Tucci.
Yeah. Because, like, I don't know, maybe it's the British bias, but now I'm actually maybe more into Mark Strong. No, he can't be Mark Strong because he has to be like another Shaw brother or like an uncle. Like, he has to be something along those lines. And then we need a Shaw father who has to be an old, bald British actor. Anthony Hopkins. Yeah.
Easy low hanging fruit.
That would explain the Welsh thing with Luke Evans. Yeah. There we go. I've tied it all together.
Yeah. Hopkins, got so many Oscar winners now.
You heard it here
that's
first,
why that
people.
That's Welsh.
Yeah. Did you guys go see this in the theater, both of you?
Yeah, unfortunately.
Yes, I did.
What did you guys go in there with low expectations, high expectations? What were you expecting? What did you get?
I was kind of excited.
Kind of.
I know I will say I was kind of excited, and my fiance, who will inevitably listen to this, will text me when she listens saying, don't be a liar. Because the truth is I was probably very, very excited because I think the trailers look good. I think for me, it was like, oh, this is The Rock doing a thing I actually liked him doing. Cause this was also in a period where I was like, Rampage, Skyscraper. Like, this isn't what I like about The Rock. And I think you even said in that episode, you like that more anti-hero villainous Rock, which is what Hobbs always was.
Yeah, for a bit there, yeah.
Yeah, and it's like, even in 6 and 7, he's not in 7 as much, but in 6 he's still a bit antagonistic. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And like 8, he's antagonistic towards Toretto.
Yeah.
And I was like, this will be great, because he'll be the big guy who's like aggro towards Statham. With his goatee, and then he doesn't have the goatee. No. He's like weirdly making jokes. And so I come out of it and, you know, I didn't see it. I remember I saw it in like a small cinema. And I remember and British crowds don't normally cheer or react to things.
Okay.
But, or European crowds in general don't. Cause I remember, you know, a lot of things I've seen, they just don't react, even if people like it. But it's just the way we are, right? But Fast and Furious had always sort of been something where, you know, I remember seeing 7 when I was in Paris, and like, not just the Paul Walker thing at the end, but when they go through the towers and when they're like doing the mountain drop, like people reacted, they cheered, they were excited. And like, it was the same with 8, which I don't think is great, but there were still moments that people just respond to naturally. And it's like, it was just silence throughout Hobbs and Shaw. Like, people didn't even really laugh at the jokes.
Did you like the jokes, Joe?
No.
Oh, that's it. Okay.
This movie irritated me. And I was, because I was, like I said, I was a little excited. I was a little burnt because of 8. I've expressed this before. For some reason, Paul Walker really just is his absence is very like well missed in 8. And then in this one, I'm just like, well, now we don't even have Vin Diesel. And like, you missed the heart. The heart is missing. Like you said, it's just totally like to the side. And I wasn't vibing with it at all. And it bummed me out.
Okay. As someone who watched all 8 recently, not for this, just because I'm just like that fun. As a person.
Yeah.
Where over the space of like 3 days, I rewatched all 8 Fast and Furious films.
Oh my goodness.
Hell yeah.
But there's a reason, right, where it's like, I didn't watch this. I wouldn't have watched this except for this, right, that I knew I was going to be on here.
Yeah.
And I think that's like the most damning thing because like Too Fast, Too Furious is a movie that I don't think is like excellent.
Yeah.
And same with Fate of the Furious.
Yeah.
But I still sat there and I watched them and I was like, man, you know what? End of the day, I love Fast and Furious. There are some things like, and I think we all have something like that where I'm a bit like that with Star Wars, where it's like, I love Star Wars enough where bad Star Wars to me is still entertaining. And like Godzilla is another example where it's like that Godzilla versus Kong movie on paper, if I had to critically look at it, is not good.
No.
But Godzilla fights Kong, and I'm like, yeah, here we go. And this film is called Fast and Furious Presents Hobbs and Shaw, and Fast and Furious sure do present me something, and that thing is Hobbs and Shaw. Yet I left there and I was so cold, where I was like, but you have betrayed me, because this isn't Hobbs and Shaw, this is Jason Statham and The Rock, and Fast and Furious are barely presenting this movie, they're presenting the last 20 minutes at most.
Yeah.
So I have, first, probably because of this podcast, I am now being heavily advertised via these web ads, this Fast 9 movie. Nice. Are you guys excited for it? Are you looking forward to it? What are you expecting?
I'm so excited.
I am ecstatic, but I've only seen the first trailer from last year, and I know there's spoilers in the new one, and I don't want to have it spoiled because I just still want it to be a surprise. So I
wouldn't say anything in that case, but of the two experiences I've had going back to the cinema, when I saw Godzilla vs. Kong in Mortal Kombat, I saw them in the IMAX. They play the trailers for Fast 9. And it's electric. Like, and I don't know how much of that is simply... because I almost teared up at the end of this movie when the granddaughter meets the grandmother, like, for the first time. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is more of a symptom of, I live in California, my family live in England, there has been a lockdown and a quarantine. I think that is just playing into that. That is, like, a reaction based more on, man, I miss my fam.
Yeah.
And that might be part of it with Fast 9 of just, boy, look at this real movie. But yeah, real. All that being said, I mean, you've seen the first trailer, right? There's that moment where, firstly, like with Han, all that stuff is like, that's great. And then they just swing a car off a bridge that's collapsing and drive it up a mountain. And what more do you want from cinema?
I just couldn't have the smile wiped off my face, like, through the next trailer when I watched it. I was just, and then I'm like a huge John Cena fan now, like in the last like 4 years. And I'm just like, oh my God, they've added my new favorite comedy star. Like, I'm
so excited for Cena.
Yeah.
I love that Cena's playing his brother. It's insane. Yes,
it's brilliant. It's, I love it. I'm just, bring it on.
Because, you know, when I look at Jordana Brewster and Vin Diesel in my head, that third piece, John Cena.
All right, let's take a brief pause here to go on to episode 9 of The Young Rock. Lev, cue the bump.
What the Rock is cooking? Istanbul was Constantinople, now it's Istanbul, not Constantinople, been a long.
All right, Lawrence, you didn't have to, but did you watch this episode of Young Rock?
No, I did not, but I also did some cursory reading about Young Rock and discovered things I did not know about this show.
Yeah?
Basic premise.
Yeah. Yeah, what's jumping out at you about it?
So, I get, like, The Rock playing, doing the president thing, I knew about. Yeah. That was something I knew about the conceit. I didn't realize that Randall Park is playing a version of himself that became, like, a news guy.
That
has, like, a news show. That is so... strange. That is just such a baffling, like, different thing, and I'm like, why did you bother? Why not just have him play like some character? I just don't get the point.
Well, they get a lot of mileage out of him talking about how he used to be an actor when he's talking with The Rock, and then The Rock sort of like dunks on him. Randall Park, the best part of the show.
Could have told you that without seeing it.
Yeah. It's also so weird that they're like assuming that he's not going to be an actor anymore, but he also looks really good for his age.
Yeah, it's just a little joke. That's all. Like, he had been on Fresh Off the Boat, which was her previous show. So, like, it makes sense. And they probably have a better relationship than with Constance Wu at this point. So that's where you're at now. Yeah. So, okay. Joe, did you watch this? Do you watch these anymore? No?
I gave up on it.
Well, I won't talk about it much.
Don't watch this anymore.
I won't talk about it much because it's just 5-year-old Rock and those episodes are always the worst. But essentially the premise in this episode is The Rock is having a debate with his opposition, and then he gets asked a question about what he wants his legacy to be. So then he goes into, like, let me tell you a quick story. But of course, it takes the whole episode. And then at the end, the opponent's like, what the fuck? You gave him 22 minutes to do a 2-minute thing? Why didn't you call time on him? And then the show's over.
Is this show just his Instagram posts adapted to a TV show? That's what this is, right?
Shit The Rock says. Yeah, that's what we have.
Because like his Instagram posts are these long sprawling things when he was like, you know, Rampage, and my dad took me to the arcade and I played Rampage on the old arcade machine. It's like a very long detailed post about him playing Rampage. And he's like, then, you know, go see it like June 12th or whatever. That's crazy. Yeah,
that's basically what we get
this
here.
This guy is like, he's taken over, and it's too much now. And the fact that he's actually putting out a bid for presidency is haunting.
Well, listen, he hasn't technically come out and said he's actually doing it yet, but obviously he does want to.
He's considering it.
He's on basic cable, right, or whatever the fuck it is. What is it? What's he on, NBC?
Yeah, it's broadcast.
That's a network.
Yeah,
we're so fucked.
He's campaigning. This is campaigning.
He's got a second season where he's gonna be like, "Well, this is going great for me. We got good ratings."
I think this was a bit of like why they kind of did this Samoa stuff at the end of the movie. I think that was a plant. Right? Like, look at my heritage. Look at my tribe. Like, look at my humble origins here.
My cousin is the biggest champion in the other company or whatever.
Like, it's all part of the scheme.
Well, it's like he even drinks tequila in Hobbs and Shaw, right? And that's like he always has his tequila thing. He talks about tequila all the time. Yeah. It is so manufactured. that's the thing about him being a movie star to me, right? Is that I think he's indisputably a type of movie star.
Yes.
I do not think he is a classic, like, top build, like Tom Cruise, Will Smith type movie star.
Mm-hmm. Never will be.
And he never will be. And that's, I think, more of a symptom of the industry and the way it is now versus like him necessarily.
Well, I think part of that too is that those two other actors, they can act. Like, they can really bring it.
Yeah. Which obviously
certainly
really helps. But it's this thing of like, The Rock has become... This brand is like the most full quadrant thing I've seen in my life. Like it is so like, well, you know, it's like, you know me, The Rock, who used to be a child, like fellow children who want to watch this. But also, don't worry, adults, I like tequila. You know tequila from the adult things you do. And then it's like wrestling, which is the most preteen, like young boy shit in the world.
Uh-oh, Joe.
And still is. And then it's like, I guess he also constantly talks. Listen, he is a handsome guy, right? Like, I'm not going to deny that. Yep. But it is like in the films in particular where more and more there are extended bits where it's almost like he's trying to convince us he's an attractive person. He is. And I don't get why it's like he's almost insecure. And I actually always feel bad for him at that point.
So having gone through all the Rock movies at long last, I still don't quite, I think I don't quite get why everybody likes it. I've just accepted everybody really likes him. But I think why I don't like him is sort of this two-pronged assault where one, like you have a good word here, manufactured. Like he's working really hard to get everybody to like him. And like that's a thing that he needs. And those people drive me crazy. They always annoy me. But then two, the four quadrant thing is another good, like he's sort of like, I've always compared him to like, I like Sandler because he's got some quirks to him, but The Rock is like white bread. Oh. He's the most generic, viewer friendly, a little something for everybody guy. And that's just hard for me to kind of grip onto anything of note on him.
There's no edge, you know?
Yes, yes.
And like the edge is there, it's like manufactured where he's like, well, I'm playing Black Adam, famously a villain. But also my pitch for Black Adam is like, what if at one point he was a good guy? And I'm like, well,
you lost it,
you
The
need
Rock.
To, it's like, come on, like you could have just committed to it.
Yeah.
And like any edge that exists, like the goatee was edgy. Like he has it in Faster. He obviously has it in the Fast and Furious films.
Yeah.
It's like an edgy thing. And it just doesn't exist anymore because it's like, well, no, The Rock is like a nice, kind face who needs to be smooth and like looks like a doll. Like it's very strange.
All right. Well, we got to wind down now. I'd like to thank our sponsor, Pork Lobes. I don't know what they are still, but maybe find them at porklobes.com. Thank Lev and Ransula for mining those audio boards. Before we go into our goodbyes, do you guys have any last looks? What are your thoughts on this movie or The Rock in general? Why might he have picked this film?
I hope the sequel never comes out. I don't need it.
Yeah, I think the same. And I not even as a thing of I hate this movie so much, I don't want any more of it. I think it is healthier for both his star persona.
Yes.
And I think for the Fast and Furious franchise, if they work in tandem.
Yeah.
I think that sort of makes sense.
Just come back for the last two or whatever there are.
You know, he obviously, I wonder if he took this one because he got to be the star at long last, but two, if like he was like, well, I can prove that I'm the reason why the Fast and the Furious movies are good now. If this movie had outperformed the other ones, and then obviously it didn't. Well, thanks, Lawrence, for stopping by this week. Do you have a place where people could follow your films or your random thoughts?
No, for someone who talks as much as I do about a lot of nonsense, I've made the smart choice of not ever saying anything online. I guess if you No, I actually realized there's literally nothing. You can follow a private Instagram page that I only let you follow if I know who you are.
Okay, so probably don't do that.
Or you can go to a Twitter page, which does nothing.
Okay.
Excellent. I love this. Right.
Well, that sounds easy to do then in the notes. Joe, I'm glad you were able to make it back here, and I'm glad we'll get to finish off The Rock with you next, so that's going to be good. I am your host, Patrick Scale. You can find my features, documentaries, short films, animations, behind-the-scenes footage, video essays, and so much more at QuixoticUnited.com and social media, presumably, with a similar sounding name. Thank you all for listening. Joe, say goodnight.
Good night.
Probably knowing me as weirdly, I was an adventurous child. I almost certainly ran into something.
Okay.
Like I was definitely like up a tree. I don't think it was a natural process for me losing that tooth.
Joe, when did you lose your first tooth?
I have no idea, but it was not till way too late because my teeth were awful and my adult teeth grew in over my baby teeth. I needed braces so badly.
Maybe the implication there is that your baby teeth were so good, you know, they just were that's how good they were. They could stick around. They had a lot of life left in them.
Yeah, unlike my teeth, which are falling out like just for no reason. Like I'd think about biting an apple and it would start to shake.
I think I was about 7 when I lost mine. So are you feeding Ellie like a bunch of junk food? Is that what's going on?
No.
You're rotting the teeth out of her head?
Like fucking champions.
Wheaties then.
It's all veggies and fruits and like, you know.
Well, I wholeheartedly approve of that diet. Well done, Jim.
Yeah, that's very impressive.
Yeah.
I feel like in America we feed our children garbage cereal too much. That's only sugar.
Yeah. Ellie has caught on to like the sweets sometimes and we're like, no, you can have a treat once a week.
Do you know they have what I saw in the store this week was cookies and cream flavored Oreos. Isn't that already an Oreo? Isn't that the whole point of the Oreo is to be cookies and cream?
That's too much.
It's like Oreoception.
That speaks to like a level of laziness of the implication being you can't be bothered to even bite the original Oreo to combine the two flavors.
Where you're from, Lawrence, do you have a problem with sugary things or what's the food situation there?
I mean, in England, it's like, I don't know. I feel like it's one of those strange things where because of pop culture and whatever, America became so synonymous with it. And as often we do with a lot of things, the English sit back and go, ha, Americans, as if we don't have the exact same issues.
I see. Okay.
Like, cause like there's a reason Jamie Oliver went around to like every school in the country to be like, we should maybe eat healthy. And every school child was like, no, get fucked, Jamie Oliver. Like, I was never into sweets. I was just such a picky eater where it was like, I ate more pasta and wheat-based things than I think any child of any age or even any adult probably should have growing up.
Yes, ideally.
Because I was like vegetarian until I was 12 and I hated vegetables and I hated fruit. So it really
you can't eat anything. There's a lot of vegetarians like that here. And then they have vegan stuff and vegetarian stuff that's just filled with crap. So like it's not really healthier eating at that point.
Yeah, now I just don't care. I just eat, I don't know. I eat when I'm hungry. If I'm not hungry, I guess I don't eat now. I guess that's the one thing I could say about my eating habits is that they're acceptable.
Joe, do you remember the big fight in our high school to get the sodas out of the vending machines there and like how nobody wanted to let them do that and the compromise was, okay, we'll take out the Coke, but we'll leave in the Powerade. What? Yeah. Do you remember that, Joe?
No? Not at all.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah.
High school is a blur at the moment. So that was a lifetime ago.
All right. Well, I think we can dive on in then. Huh? You guys want to do that?
Yeah.
All right.